In the beginning, darkness was on the face of the earth. And God said, let there be light. And God created creatures of every kind. But humanity has exploited his creation in the name of the almighty dollar. Until today, thousands of species are on the brink of extinction. But there are those who are acting to save endangered species before it's too late.
In the closing years of the 20th century, at a time when God's creation was under its greatest threat, as species of plants and animals were daily being added to the endangered species list, or worse, succumbing to extinction, as humanity's insatiable appetite found fresh ways to exploit the planet and threaten the creatures that dwelt there, a new species, previously almost unknown, fell under humanity's gaze. This species, which had managed to escape humanity's hungry eyes, came from the same place as the mystical dolphins. Itself. This creature, the whale shark, which shared the depths of the ocean with a myriad of other creatures of the deep, was no threat to humanity at all. It was as gentle as a lamb, yet it is the biggest of its kind. Since the beginning of time and across millions of years, the whale shark has cruised the oceans of the planet almost unnoticed. Despite its huge size, it was as if it was invisible to would-be hunters. overlooked, it lived a serene life, totally suited to its demeanor. As if divinely protected, this species seemed to have been inadvertently omitted from the great book of animals to be hunted and exploited. That is, until at last, almost by mistake, the gaze of humanity fell upon the whale shark. And today, in some countries, it is a delicacy to be eaten at $10 a kilo. The whale shark is probably the most laid-back species created. Its only desire to dine on its fare of krill, plankton, and other microscopic organisms. The whale shark is an enigma. Still one of the great mysteries of the sea. Each year, at certain times, in certain places, these huge fish appear. They hang around for a short time and then disappear again. No one really knows where they come from or where they go to. What is known is that it can be found around the subtropical zones, right around the world. That the whale shark is a filter feeder. It takes in 6,000 litres, or 1,500 gallons of water, every hour. As it feeds, it passes these huge volumes of water through its gills, causing them to flare out. One of the results being that the shark has to clean its gills. This coughing dislodges the small pieces of food that have become lodged in the gill rakers. As the biggest fish in the sea, the whale shark has very small eyes. Scientists believe that the whale shark has poor eyesight and think it would certainly find it difficult in locating food if it relied solely on its eyesight. Scientists believe that the whale shark, like most sharks, have an extremely sensitive sense of smell. Their nostrils are located just above their mouth, allowing a continual flow of water past this extremely important sensing organ. The most important sense is the whale shark's sixth sense. This sixth sense is a vibratory sensory system which runs along the flank of the beast and runs from the top of the head and ends at the tip of the tail. This sixth sense, which all sharks have, helps to identify and locate prey and predators. And that is about all that is known of these elusive creatures. Not much at all, when you remember they are the biggest fish in the sea. In fact, they are so elusive, up until the mid-1990s, there had only been 320 recorded sightings worldwide. One of the scientists who is trying to increase this knowledge of the whale shark is Dr. Scott Urquhart from California.
It's clear that whale sharks are seasonal in many places of the world, primarily in tropical areas, but except for that short seasonal period, they're gone from our view for the rest of that time.
For some years, Dr. Urquhart has been satellite tagging whale sharks in an attempt to discover where they go when they disappear from humanity's eyes.
We've got this world's largest fish, wanders the world's oceans without seeming to be concerned for boundaries or limitations of any sort. And now we can finally follow that animal and better understand why it fits into the environment that it exists in.
And since he has been following the whale sharks with satellite telemetry, he has discovered that this species could literally be a true citizen of the world, using the world's oceans as their neighborhood. Gypsies of the deep, wandering where they will. It seems certain age groups and genders hang out together in certain parts of the world. In the Pacific, off California, there seems to be a huge number of older females, perhaps the grandmothers of the species. At Ningaloo, off Western Australia, young males, immature and adolescent. And off the coast of Taiwan, females. What's more, pregnant females. In fact, it's thought that the waters off Taiwan may be one of the world's most important locations for whale sharks, because it's the only place in the world where pregnant whale sharks have been landed. Therefore, researchers believe that it is a birthing ground for the species. And this is a big concern for conservationists, because Taiwan, which has a huge fishing fleet, is the one nation in the world which aggressively hunts the whale shark, and any other shark for that matter, common or endangered species alike. This is Suao in North Taiwan, one of the country's main wholesale fishing markets. This is where the whale sharks and other catches are auctioned. This is a sad sight. What we see here is astonishing. There are rare giant hammerhead sharks, sandbar whalers, tiger sharks, grey nursing sharks, and many, many more. Just part of the 100 million sharks a year taken from our oceans globally. These shark fins and the rest of the carcass are destined for dinner tables in restaurants and retail markets in Taiwan, Singapore, Hong Kong, and mainland China. The Taiwanese, infamous for their exotic palate. The evidence for this is in their markets. And this is whale shark meat displayed openly at $10 a kilo. And why shouldn't it be displayed openly? It's not illegal to sell whale shark meat here in Taiwan. And it's certainly not a crime to eat it. But there are those in Taiwan who are concerned about this.
We have been working on sharks for many years, but in the recent years we started to working on whale sharks, particularly.
The fish market serves as a research laboratory for Professor Liu and his colleague Professor Yong of the Nation of Taiwan Ocean University. They have been studying whale sharks since around 1995 and have an arrangement with the fishermen at this market. They regularly bring their students down to gather data on catches. They are concerned that there are no controls on whale shark fishing in Taiwan's waters.
We don't have enough information to know whether the population is declining. The only data we have is just the the catch is declining. So it's difficult to tell whether we should totally ban the shark fishery.
The professor's concern was heightened in 1995 when the fishermen called them to see their biggest catch ever, a huge whale shark.
One day the fishermen called us, said they caught a female whale shark with lots of embryos.
As these pictures show, the female was full of unborn whale sharks, more than 300. These embryos were in three different stages of development. So rare was this find, they were frozen for research purposes. Some were still in their eggs, while the biggest were free of their egg cases and without a yolk sac, and at around half a meter long were ready to be born. What's more, 15 were still alive inside their dead mother. There were also thousands of small ova, each less than 1 centimeter in diameter. This finding is probably the most important discovery about whale sharks so far. Until this time, science thought whale sharks laid eggs like most other fish. But this find proved once and for all that whale shark eggs hatch inside the mother's body and she gives birth to live young. But this discovery raises more questions, like, does the female give birth to a school of whale sharks? Or do the offspring emerge individually over a period of time? If so, is that period of time hours, days, or weeks? Another question is, where are these tiny whale sharks? The smallest ever recorded alive in the ocean was this one at Ningaloo in Western Australia, a mere 2.9 metres long. Another important question concerns mortality. Although a female whale shark can carry more than 300 young and have the reproductive ability to produce thousands of offspring, no one knows the survival rate of these pups. Perhaps their mortality should be compared to that of the turtle, which lays thousands of eggs. But very few of the hatchlings survive. So the catch of a single whale shark, pregnant or otherwise, has a larger effect on the whale shark population than anyone could possibly imagine. Like most other large sharks, the whale shark takes many years to reach sexual maturity, maybe as long as 30 years. And because of this, and the incredible decline in numbers, it's believed that mating opportunities are now becoming extremely rare. This problem is compounded by the fact that an average-sized 10-ton animal could fetch as much as $70,000. Therefore, the larger whale sharks, the breeding stock, are being targeted. Which means the death of a single whale shark, especially a female carrying more than 300 pups, is a devastating blow to the global whale shark population. So unless the Taiwanese stop hunting the whale sharks, this species has a real possibility of being eaten to extinction. Fortunately, that is not the case elsewhere in the world. Like in the Philippines. The Philippines is one of the world's best kept secrets. Its countryside is as beautiful and as colourful as its people. Being one of the world's poorest nations, it has as many political and social problems as it has islands. But this nation's love for life and its deeply held religious beliefs have resulted in an amazing event. In a country that many Westerners would call backward, in a country where a town like Donsol, in the province of Sorsogon, in the shadow of one of the world's most active and beautiful volcanoes, a place where there are only two telephones for 30,000 people. They have done a remarkable thing. Below the waters of the South China Sea, which laps the shores of Donsol, live many whale sharks, or butonding, as the locals call them. In fact, scientists believe these waters hold the greatest concentration of whale sharks anywhere in the world. Schools of as many as 30 of these giants have been seen congregating. Despite the fact that whale sharks or the butonding have never been hunted in this part of the Philippines, they were hunted elsewhere. And because of this, the folk of Donsol feared that hunters from other islands would descend on their coastline. So, in 1998, the local municipality declared the whale shark a protected species.
And in fact, there was an ordinance passed in the municipality declaring the Donsol coastline as a sanctuary for whale shark.
The vice mayor of Donsol, Donny Cloef, says one of the main people in the Save the Whale Shark movement was Karina Escudado.
I got involved in saving the Butanding. It all started during the launch of the International Year of the Oceans.
Karina had already fallen in love with the whale sharks years before and decided to make it her mission to save them. She went to Donsol to persuade the local government to save the Butanding, and they didn't take much convincing.
The people of Donsol has lived with the whale shark for so long, and then they were happy that these gentle creatures were protected by the law.
And it seems that the new law came just in time. 2 days after Karina had walked away from Donsol with a copy of the new law banning whale shark hunting, hunters came to town seeking permission to kill.
I think we were just very, very lucky. Somebody up there is watching this place. I know it because, I mean, just check it out, the timing. I mean, by the time these guys came here to apply for this, they just couldn't get it. We got here first. We're just lucky we got here first.
In fact, the local ban on whale shark hunting was so popular, it forced the federal government to follow this tiny town's lead. What makes the success of this ban on whale shark fishing even more remarkable is the fact that before the ban, a whale shark could earn a Filipino fisherman around $1,000. But after the ban, merchants were offering 10 times that amount on the black market.
Well, the whale sharks here in the Philippines are quite threatened because of a fishery and a market that's out there for the whale sharks.
A.A. Yuptanchai is a project officer with the Worldwide Fund for Nature. He is looking at ways of helping local fishermen resist the temptation of the big bucks that can be made from the black market.
I know WWF has been involved in conservation of fishery stocks and sharks in general, but focusing on the whale shark, this is the only one that they're implementing.
And he has found an alternative livelihood for the fishermen. The WWF has organized them into a collective which has embraced ecotourism. A cooperative of the town's fishermen who take it in turns to take the tourists out to swim with the whale sharks. These are the ecotourists who bring life to the whale shark and the Philippine villages. They bring environmentally friendly dollars. And old-timers are happy to tell the tourists about the times when whale sharks were even more numerous than they are today. He says while he was earning a living, fishing, there was a time when he encountered an accident with the whale sharks. He went out fishing. He fished all night. It was early morning when his boat hit a whale shark and the propeller came off. Suddenly, they were surrounded by lots and lots of whale sharks. They were fighting with the boat. They were thrashing around with their tails and they were smashing into the boat. He ended up in the water. There were some floating pieces of the boat and he grabbed onto these to stay afloat. He was very scared. He was floating out to sea, holding onto a piece of wood. Other fishermen came out to rescue him. When he was picked up, the whale sharks were everywhere. He was very afraid because he thought he'd be eaten by the sharks. But the whale sharks didn't harm him. He says they were just there. Today, instead of hunting whale sharks, this old sea dog has been taught a new trick. He is part of the new generation of hunters who hunt with cameras and with tourists. Another underestimated nation, which also deserves recognition for its environmentally friendly policies, lies half a world away in the Indian Ocean. The archipelago that is the Seychelles. Here at certain times of the year, these waters, like the Philippines, have scores of whale sharks. In these warm tropical waters, a dozen or more whale sharks have been known to hang out and interact with one another. But like everywhere else, the whale shark numbers in the Seychelles seem to be on the decline.
Whale sharks are very much still an enigma.
David Rowett is a whale shark dive tour operator. He's also a conservationist, working closely with the Seychelles government on ways to protect the whale shark.
The Endangered Species IUCN Red Data Book lists the whale shark as data deficient. And that says that we don't know enough about this animal to say whether there's a lot of them or not a lot of them, and whether it's threatened or endangered or not. And so with that, I try to find out a little bit more.
And as far as David is concerned, until those questions are answered, the whale shark should be protected. And like the Philippines, this tiny nation of the Seychelles, with its less than 1 million people, is likely to declare the whale shark just that, protected.
The Seychelles has been an eco nation for about 20 years.
Gilbert Poul is the Seychelles president's special advisor. In 1999, he devised a new approach to ecotourism with the introduction of the Seychelles Gold Card.
Well, there's so much we wanted to put on the card, but we finally felt it was best to keep it as simple as possible. So we've gone for some striking, clean images of the Seychelles. First of all, our green is our gold. It puts across the message that really our main source of resources in Seychelles is our greenery, our environment, our nature. So we feel that this line really puts that message across. And then we find a clean, nice beach on one of the small islands with one of our rare shells. And of course, a little logo that shows the sun bringing out the life in our green nature.
He says this gold card will help maintain the 46% of the Seychelles, which is today protected. He says there is no other nation in the world which has declared almost 50% of itself protected. This protection has one single aim: to preserve and enhance the Seychelles' unique wildlife, its amazing array of birds, its giant tortoises. It's primeval Valley de May. But the government and conservation groups are beginning to realize that despite the fact almost 50% of the nation is protected, events elsewhere in the world are impacting on them. For example, they have noticed a marked reduction in the number of whale sharks in their waters. They too believe that this amazing creature is a citizen of the world, a true gypsy of the deep, and is in fact a classic example of the web of life. An example of what happens to whale sharks 15,000 miles away impacts on marine life in their backyard. That the hunting of whale sharks by Taiwanese fishermen is having a detrimental effect on their whale shark numbers.
Over the last 5 years, the whale shark fishing industry has really taken off, especially in the Far East. And with a shark that grows so slowly and matures so late, even the numbers that they're taking now are not sustainable. At least that's what we believe, which is why we're doing the work.
In the Seychelles, the conservationists have begun tagging whale sharks to see where they go. But that question is becoming academic, as declining numbers means fewer sightings and fewer sharks to tag. Meanwhile, another tagging expedition is underway, this time back in Domsol in the Philippines. In fact, there are two tag teams hoping to meet up with the Domsol whale sharks. Dr. Scott Urquhart from California and his team is one group. They have brought across satellite tracking devices which they hope will be able to tell them if any of the Filipino whale sharks ever venture outside the South China Sea.
So we came here with our satellite telemetry devices, as well as our ability to look at genetic fingerprinting of the sharks to determine if these sharks are truly a resident population or if they are a population that are connected to elsewhere, other areas of the Pacific, such as in Ningaloo Reef in Australia.
The other team belongs to Denise Newbound. She has a totally different plan of attack.
As a biologist, I look at the whale shark as a fish. It's a shark, and it functions as a shark. It swims through the ocean, and it's looking for food.
Denise has been studying whale sharks for about 2 years, and while others like Dr. Urquhart and Dave Roat have been tracking them by using tags, Denise is trying to track whale sharks by using a biological method, by collecting copepods from the whale shark's skin.
Copepod is a type of crustacean, and the big broad group of crustaceans includes all your lobsters, your crayfish, your crabs, that kind of stuff. There's many, many species of copepods. It's basically like your insects of the sea. There's humongous numbers, hugely abundant, many different species, diverse species. You get some species that are commensal, live on other animals, live on fish, in this case live on sharks.
Only these creatures on the whale shark eat bacteria off its skin. A symbiotic relationship. Both creatures benefit.
But once I've located whale sharks, determined that the shark, you know, is probably going to be okay with me duck diving, I just duck dive down, use forceps, which are like a big set of tweezers, very fine pointy ends, remove the copepod back to the surface and put it in a container back to the boat.
And while Denise is searching out whale sharks to track them biologically, Dr. Urquhart is preparing his high-tech gear to help him track these gypsies of the deep.
The transmitter sends a signal, very low wattage signal, about a quarter of a watt, to one of four polar orbiting satellites. These satellites then use the signal that it's receiving to determine its location on the surface of the ocean.
Normally at this time of year in Domsol, there are scores of whale sharks swimming around. According to the locals, the conditions are perfect for the whale sharks. the moon is in the right quarter, there is plenty of krill around, therefore whale shark numbers should be high. So now it's a case of waiting and seeing. Dr. Eckhart on his boat and Denise Newbound on hers, both tacking along the coast searching for the big fish. But for the scientists, they are proving elusive. March 22nd, 1999, and Cyclone Vance smashes into Exmouth on the Ningaloo Reef in Western Australia, right at the beginning of the whale shark season. Winds reached 267 kilometres an hour. It was the strongest ever cyclone to hit the Australian mainland. Exmouth was virtually destroyed. Tour operators were convinced the whale shark season was wrecked. They were right. However, their loss was another's gain. The whale sharks stayed clear of Exmouth for most of the season, preferring to cruise 150 kilometres further south on Ningaloo Reef at Coral Bay. Although the whale sharks were remaining elusive in the Philippines, despite the cyclone, Ningaloo was having one of its best seasons ever. And there's another difference. Unlike the Philippines and the Seychelles, where whale sharks congregate in large numbers, Ningaloo sharks tend to be solitary. However, the waters around Ningaloo, where the sharks are found, have possibly the clearest waters in the world. And without a doubt, divers who come to this area to swim with the whale sharks are rarely disappointed. Brad Norman has been studying the whale shark's behaviour at Ningaloo for 5 years. He has the world's largest collection of whale shark photo IDs, and it's doubted that any other scientist has swum with more whale sharks than he has. Brad Norman's work centres on whether the whale sharks of Ningaloo are permanent residents or temporary. His research leads him to agree that the whale shark is a gypsy of the deep.
We don't know where they travel to when they leave Ningaloo. We don't know where they come from before they get here. We don't know basically how often they breed, how fast they grow.
Brad says that it's likely that some whale sharks make extensive migrations, while it is also equally possible that other whale sharks remain in the area where the food resources are high, staying within a fairly local range. To help prove this, in the summer of 1999, he successfully satellite tagged a whale shark.
Up until a couple of months ago, we were getting some really good readings back from where it was moving to and from, and it actually moved a little bit further north, which for us is very important because in areas in Asia where they're hunted, we want to know if our sharks go to those regions. But until we have some really good information on whale shark numbers and their migratory routes, it's very hard to encourage global protection. But, you know, if we chip away at the research, finding out more information about them, I really think that we're going to have the ability to protect them and hopefully ensure they stay around forever.
Twice a year, in March and April, more than 200 species of coral, which is the Ningaloo Reef, spawn, bringing in sea life of all kinds to form a definitive microcosm of the food chain as the Indian Ocean turns into a nutrient-rich soup de poisson. The coral coral spawning, which causes huge plankton blooms, is devoured by small bait fish. Which in turn are devoured by tuna and other larger fish. Which are in turn eaten by sharks at the top of the food chain. Meanwhile, the whale shark, who when fully grown has no real predators, cruises in amongst the melee, taking what it needs. Dr. Jeff Taylor has been studying whale sharks since the mid-1980s. He was one of the first to connect whale sharks to coral spawning.
The numbers of whale sharks build up very quickly after the first coral spawning. And you can almost predict to the day when one's going to have the biggest numbers of whale sharks out there. And it's always in that period, 2 to 3 weeks after the first coral spawning.
But this type of feeding frenzy is rare. Usually the whale sharks are calmly cruising the oceans just below the surface, doing what the scientists describe as passive feeding. Just gliding along with their mouths open, eating whatever enters. Meanwhile, the whale shark's escort fish follow on, or rather, in the pilot fish case, leads the way. It was thought that these juvenile golden trevally led the whale shark to its food, but it has now been discovered that in fact these fish use the pressure wave of the whale shark to push them along. Or like this cobia, who has just been the victim of a serious mugging, taking shelter above the whale shark's pectoral fin. Then there are the remoras, the suckerfish, hitchhikers who have grabbed a free ride and opportunistically grab a free feed whenever they can. These escort fish take little notice of Brad Norman as he continues his research. As well as building his photo ID library, he also physically measures the length of the whale sharks he encounters. Ningaloo's solitary sharks are predominantly young, immature males. While male whale sharks mature sexually at around 8.5 meters, this little one of just under 3 meters is the smallest whale shark ever recorded. This means that although this whale shark is almost 3 meters long, scientists don't know how old it is. It could be as young as 3 months or as old as 3 years. It's all part of the whale shark enigma.
Very little is known about the whale sharks, considering they're the largest fish in the ocean. Having only been really discovered by science in 1829, we haven't got a long history of any work that's been done on them. Even up until a few years ago, we didn't know how they actually bred, if they produced live young or laid eggs. We're starting to slowly chip away at finding out these different important aspects of the whale shark's biology, and I know that in the near future we'll be able to break some more ground on them.
And it's the excitement of swimming with these gentle giants and the publicity that this has brought, which is helping raise the awareness of the plight of these creatures.
I think ecotourism has great value. It provides the opportunity for the general public from all walks of life and from all countries to see these sharks in their own environment and in their natural state. So it brings people in, they can appreciate the animals, in their natural state, but also the hundreds or the thousands of people that get to swim with sharks can say, hey, they're a very, very special animal. We should do everything we can to protect them and try and ensure that their conservation is upheld.
Whale sharks became a favourite of the divers in the early 1990s, and since then thousands of divers have made a pilgrimage to Exmouth and Coral Bay to swim with these creatures.
Many of those animals have been resighted from year to year. There's one or two favourites. There's one called Stumpy that's got no dorsal fin to its tail. That's a very popular animal because it swims so slowly and people can swim along with it for hours on end. There's another particular animal that's got a huge gash down the side of its gill. We've nicknamed that one Arthur Scargill. They're not there every year, but every second or third year we'll see them again.
One of the reasons for Ningaloo's success is that it is one of the most predictable and easiest places in the world to see whale sharks. Meanwhile, while Brad continues his work with the numerous whale sharks visiting Ningaloo, in Donsal in the Philippines, Denise Newbound and Scott Eckhart are chasing their first sighting. But despite a few false alarms, at last some action, and Denise's team spots a solitary shark. Unfortunately, the visibility is too low for Denise to be able to find the tiny copepod she wants to take from the whale shark's skin, and she returns to the surface empty-handed. As for Scott, even worse luck, no shark at all. His trip was in vain. And the scientist is obviously concerned at the lack of whale sharks in an area renowned for their abundance, and at a time when whale sharks should be there, plenty of krill, and the moon in the right quarter. He says alarm bells should be ringing.
The whale shark is technically not listed as a protected or as an endangered species yet, but they are a species of concern. And the reason is that we don't really know what the population sizes are. We know there are certain factors perturbing the populations, but we have so little information on the species that we have to be a little worried when we see populations being harvested. Everything that we've learned about shark populations, and in fact, all of these large, long-lived, slow-reproducing vertebrates, indicate that they do not deal well with high harvests. And to say that just because we don't have enough information, that we must therefore be allowed to continue to harvest them at unregulated rates is foolish, in my opinion. When you don't know enough to manage a population properly, then you're better off not utilizing that population until you do. Because every time we've tried it the other way, where we said, well, let's just go ahead and take some and find out what happens, we've done it wrong. The decline of all fisheries in the world are an example of why those previous management scenarios were improper.
It's really important our oceans are protected. It's too easy to think that, you know, they're there, we can do what we like, you know, it's okay, nothing's going to change too dramatically, but it's not the case. You can see where you're having dynamite fishing, you can see where large animals like whale sharks or even apex predators like sharks that are quite important in an ecosystem are being wiped out. And the implications of that are just too huge to even consider. And so, really, we just do have to look after our oceans.
So both Denise and Scott agree that uncontrolled fishing of the whale shark must be halted. That idea is shared by Dave Wright.
So the whale shark is fairly symbolic because this animal is an indicator of the health of the world's oceans, because this creature travels the world's oceans. It feeds in the world's oceans and it lives on the marine life that is in the different oceans, in the different areas. And so its welfare really is pretty critical to the welfare of the ocean. not that the whale shark is the caretaker of the ocean, it's more of an indicator of the ocean's, I think, sort of reproductive capacity.
And all three researchers agree that controlled ecotourism is a preferred alternative to whale shark fishing. They say that countries worldwide should be encouraged to embrace controlled ecotourism rather than hunting, just as the people of Donsel have done. The small step taken by this tiny town, which resulted in the total banning of whale shark hunting in the Philippines, they say, is a movement which must be applauded and encouraged. Likewise, the Seychelles. One of the world's smallest nations, yet almost 50% of its territory is protected. And they encourage other countries around the world, particularly Taiwan, to follow the Philippines and the Seychelles' lead. Scientific research appears to show that the whale shark is a citizen of the world, a gypsy roaming the global waters at will. The fear is, if the whale shark isn't given the sanctuary of international protection and whale shark harvesting continues unchecked, then pretty soon, maybe within 10 short years, this amazingly gentle giant we call the whale shark could become extinct.